here is the question. How many of you are involved in any way in hiring people? Hiring people in any way? How easy is that? Getting someone competent and good that you actually are happy with?
Easy.
Really? Maybe I need to hire you. So one of the things that we do when we hire people is give them some sort of a test that usually involve writing code, because I found a lot of people who can talk very, very well about what they've done and how they've done it, but when you put them in front of code and ask them to do something, they look at me like, but I'm an architect. I work in PowerPoint and maybe Word. So the problem with that is like going to a doctor that believes that rentgen is evil, and so x-rays is evil, and you should never take any sort of medication. Just fast and meditate and everything would be fine. Maybe for something it's working. I don't think that I would want to go to that doctor. And the same sense, architecture that isn't grounded in real software practices, and in this case, my firm belief is that software practices actually mean writing lots and lots and lots of code. Most of it would be crap code, but still, writing code and actually practicing the process of writing code and seeing what works and seeing what doesn't make things much easier in the long term. I worked with a lot of large companies, and some of them had the notion of the roving architect. Anyone knows about that? That's the guy, usually come in a suit, he sits in meetings, and he makes decisions. Now, he doesn't make decisions for his project. He doesn't make decisions for things he's accountable for. He's going to say, okay, you need to use Bstock and these three other systems. Have fun doing that. I'm going to go mess up another project now. Now, one of the problems, so as I said, one of the things that I do, I ask people to actually write code in interviews. That turned out to be a very bad idea because people kept telling me that it's impossible to write code in interviews. I'm not really sure why, because my response to that was, okay, take the code home and come back to me with an answer, and most of them don't. So I'm very happy that my filtering process is successful. But I have this piece of code is on GitHub. It's meant to serve as show me that you can look at a piece of code that is very small but still non-trivial and actually fix something meaningful. Now, the basic idea in this project is that we want to have a CLC. CLC is a code something correction. Basically a hash of all of the file content, so we can compare if things change over a directory. I actually run this on the this tool on the RavenDB directory with the idea that this has a lot of file that it can scan, so it means that it has a fair amount of work to do. Now, this is the overall architecture of the system. We use the actor model, and we have one actor that is the directory reader. It recursively goes to the directory, reads all the file name and throws them into the file readers. This is an IO bound task because it reads all of the directory files. Here we have eight, on this machine at least, eight file readers, and what they do is they use, they basically read the file into memory. They use concurrent IO to do so, using a buffering to reduce memory utilization, and this is another IO-bound operation. Then we have the CLC calculator, basically take a buffer and run the CLC computation on that. The output of CLC is an int that we can later use to do stuff. And this is a pure computation-oriented thinking. Okay? And in order to reduce memory, then we have a buffer that allocates all of the memory and handles that. Any questions so far about the architecture of the system? No. Right. Here is the code. Now, just to give you some idea, this is less than 300 lines of code, and it goes something like this. We use native Win32 methods to do the code. We use blocking collection for the actors, and then spin CRC computation, spin file readers, and then read the directory. The directory here is basically, well, we have the directories, enumerate all of the directories and add them to the work that I'm going to do, and then just enumerate all of the file and add them to the blocking collection for the for the file readers. And now we have this guy. Notice that we have we take the file, we get the file info. We use 16K buffer, blah 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 blah. We get buffer, do the reads. Whole bunch of stuff that you probably don't really care about. Error handling, and then basically what we send the buffers to this guy. This gives us the length. This gives us all of the buffer that we'll use. Notice, by the way, we always use 16K buffers. And notice that we're using this buffer pool. And here, again, notice that we have another one here that does the CRC computation. And this is, we spin a number of tasks based on how powerful this machine is. And this basically just goes, do the CRC computation, and you're done. And whole bunch of code, this is does the CRC, doesn't matter. But you know what? As you can see, this is pure. This guy is pure CRC. This is pure computation bound, nothing beyond that. And then there is the actual buffer pool. We use thread local storage. We use multiple stacks, blah, 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 blah. Okay. What's the point? What's the point of showing you also all of this code? Probably too fast for you to actually get that. Now, the thing is that I give this code to candidates. They sit on that at home, and I tell them that I want them to fix the code. There is a bug. There's actually multiple really interesting bugs there. The way that this works, these guys allocate memory, these guys return the memory to the thread local buffer pool. But because this is thread local, then basically what we have here is a memory leak. Those guys allocate memory, those guys free it by putting that in a destination that can never be reached, and the memory eventually collapse with out of memory exception. Even if we fix that, then what we found is that a memory use usage is high because of the problem, typically several gigabytes. If we fix that, still we have high CPU usage and it takes a lot of time to do so. Then we have this code. What's the difference about this code? What's the difference? Sorry? Simplicity. Where is all of the things that I need to handle? Where is the native calls to make sure this is efficient? Where is the memory buffering?
In the framework?
No. Where is the optimization for running work in parallel? Now, the really annoying part about this, that the memory usage of this code is around 40 megabytes. The highest memory use is typically a factor of the biggest file that you have. And this runs at a relatively low CPU usage. And this runs really, really, really fast. Something like 2 or 3 orders of magnitudes faster than the previous version. But the previous version actually have a problem of knowing when to stop. It doesn't have a way of saying, okay, I'm done. That's actually one of the tasks that I ask people to do. Why am I showing you this code? So I told you there is the there is this bug, there is the that's basically what I ask people to do. I don't tell them to do so, but a candidate who would come and say, you know what, I didn't bother reading your code, I think it's crap, I just rewrote it from scratch and it's much better, they would probably get much better attention than someone who would soak through all of the code and try to say, okay, I like the architecture, but and I fixed the thread pull bug, something, the buffer pull bug, something like that. There is an annoying tendency to think about software architecture as something that is good, inherently good. The more architecture that we have, the better we are. Probably because a lot of the time, the software that we write doesn't really make sense to us. How many of you ever got business requirement, and I specifically use the word requirement versus the term logic, because I find very little logic in them, that made absolutely no sense. Yeah? Okay. So to the camera, pretty much 90% of the room raised their hand and the rest are asleep. And the, can you give me an example? Something that just, are you seriously asking me to do that? My case, I think that's something I still remember. I was working for a nursing company, and my job was to make sure that elderly and the infirm have nurses scheduled to them and to take care of them. And a lot of that had to do with working with Social Security that allocate how many nursing hours to a particular patient and stuff like that. One of the features that I was requested to do was if a nurse registered to be a call that says, okay, I'm going to be unavailable for an extended period of time, then we need to offer her nursing services. Basically, the nurse, the typical profile of a nurse in this organization was a woman in the age of 40 to 55. Apparently, they had enough of their own employers going through something, from falling down and breaking a hip to, God forbid, other nasty stuff, that they saw the selling their own services to their own employers as a profitable course, which makes a lot of sense, but it was just, yeah, I don't know, just didn't feel nice. That was the problem. Other examples were in the same nursing situations. I don't want to work with her, but I don't want you to know that I don't want her to work with her. So we had to do a really elaborate security system because Jane didn't want to work with John, something like that. But it has to be that it's the fault of the system, that we never scheduled together, stuff like that. Now, when I don't have any control over the kind of system that I'm building, you know, I have to write all sorts of crazy stuff like that, then what I'm going to do, I'm going to focus on the things that I do have control over, the software architecture, and I'm going to make sure that the software architecture is going to be beautiful, like a painting, because I'm an artist, and that's what I'm, you know, who cares about nurses and scheduling stuff? I care about, look at this abstract factory that create a component factory to create commands that goes through the service bus to make sure that, what were we trying to do again? Who cares? Let's write some XML. The setting, by the way, XML now is considered a passé, but if I was trying to say that in 2008, that was like, yeah! That means that I'm doing my job right. I'm writing XML. Coding XML, because I don't want to hard code stuff. Now, so that's a problem. That's a problem because you end up with system that over time effectively corrodes. How many of you work on software that is more than 10 years old? How many of you like that? Yeah? Yeah? Okay. You need to pass around a busy scalp, people will come work for you. So, what problem? Software doesn't software isn't physical. It doesn't corrupt itself. I mean, if I go and put a car outside for a decade, I expect there to be some issues. If I go and put software out there for a decade, it should still work. I still run programs from 10 and 20 years ago. They work, they do the job. Maybe not as pretty, maybe they are not as pretty, maybe they're not as fun, but they work. So what makes software corrode? What makes software become harder and harder over time?
Changes.
Okay. Sorry?
Bug fixes.
Okay.
Bad programmers.
Okay. As is me in the past. Yeah. Sorry? Changing requirements. Okay. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. Third-party libraries. You, anyone? Yeah.
Framework changes.
Yeah. How many of you ever had to change a framework for this is what we do now? Now we come back and now we are, it used to be prototype versus jQuery. I'm sorry, I write databases for a living and I haven't done serious UI works in years. So I think now it's Ember versus the other team, whatever. So now you have to sit and write a whole bunch of code again, because this time it's going to be more efficient. That's interesting because a lot of the time we're trying very hard to avoid writing business code. Now, most of the problem with writing business code, most of the time, that is stupid, boring, and really, really annoying. I mean, seriously, you want me to validate that blah, blah, that another form? I need to write validation. It's much, much, much nicer to write validation frameworks. Okay, anyone here ever wrote validation framework? Yeah. Now, it's a room of randomly selected people and 10 people raise their hands. Okay? So, now, in the real world, we end up with stuff like this. This is for Microsoft Spain in 2011. They put out a sample of a simple way to write N-layered applications. Now, here is something really, really interesting about this diagram. Nowhere inside all of those boxes do you have a single reference to what? Sorry?
Framework.
No, there is lots of frameworks here. Trust me. Lots and lots of frameworks. Sorry? What are we trying to do? What is this application for? And I mean, there is a lot of architecture here. It's certainly pretty. You can print it, put it on the wall, throw darts at it probably. But that's a problem. So what do you do with that? How do you write system that actually makes sense and are maintainable over time? Anyone has ideas? Any idea about what we should do about this?
As little as
Sorry?
As little as possible.
As little as possible, okay. Sorry? Here is the problem. I've been hearing about Solid since, I think Solid became popular in 2009. Before that, it was Agile. Before that, it was Scrum. Before that, it was Agile. Anyone remember what was the buzzword before Agile? Sorry? Extreme programming, yes. There was Lean programming in there someplace, and I think there was also McDonald's, but I don't remember. It might have been just hungry. And so the problem is that when people start talking to me in a capitalized terms, especially if they are made into acronyms and then, you know, printed on hats and stuff like that, then you run into the same danger of falling into the Scrum pitfall. Scrum is a development methodology that someone ended up with. You need to go to a 3-day course and pay someone to say that you're a Scrum master because that's good for your CV. That's, by the way, another problem that we have. How many of you like to have a boring routine job that you get up in the morning, go to work, come home and can't really remember if something that happened at work happened today or last week? Anyone? only if he wants to want to how many of you have kids who wants that? Yeah. So how many of you wants to go to the to work pumped and have something to do and oh this is fun, this is so much fun, I'm going to do great things today. Right? This is what we want. Because it's fun. And then you realize that, okay, if I write yet another login form, login control, I think I would just that wouldn't improve my my CV. That wouldn't get me that cool job doing whatever. I have people, I've seen people who make explicit design decisions that are based on their CV. Whatever knowingly or unknowingly, I will say annoyingly to be fair, but you know, I hear that neuron service bus is a really interesting has a really interesting job opportunities. Let's say that we use that in our next project. That's you know 100,000, 200,000 just in licensing fee. But you know what? I'm going to be out of here in 3 months. Who cares? Another issue is the notion of what do you do with, how to say that? What sort of responsibility do you have for the end result? Sadly, a lot of the time, developers don't actually have responsibility for the product. The worst thing that could possibly happen in 90% of the cases, I'm not talking about medical software and stuff like that, although even there, there are some horror stories. But most of the time, worst case that can happen, it says, okay, we're firing you. And you have to wait a week and maybe go to a couple of interviews and then you find roughly the same job. Okay? At least as long as it's not 2008 again. So there is no real drive for accountability. If you mess up and the project fails, well, most project fails. I'm in the majority. I'm winning. So one of the problems that we have is that we really need to make a distinction between what is good for the project, what is good for the business, what is good for yourself. But why is there a distinction between what is good for the project, what is good for the business? Do you know? Anyone was ever in a position where what was good for the business, what was good for the project? But in the business, I'm talking about the end client. Was a divergent? I once, yeah. Can you tell me what was the situation? Okay, I used to work, I did some work for a bank and we migrated their system from Oracle to SQL Server. The reason for the migration was that my company at the time, I had a really interesting company, I learned a lot, most of it was stuff not to do. My company signed a contract to that said, okay, there is an ETL process that take eight plus hours to run. It is kicked. Is it kicked off at midnight, and it must absolutely finish by 8 a.m. This is when the bank opens. And over time, it became slower and slower and slower. And they hired us, hired my company to move it from Oracle to SQL Server. And my company had a contractual obligation to make it run under 2 hours. That's by the way before they ever saw the code. 100,000 plus. Lines of PLSQL plus another 13,000 lines of shell scripts and recursively code-generating code. So you have a SQL statement, a generated SQL statement, generated SQL statement, SQL statement, SQL statement, SQL statement, SQL statement. 7 times. And so you have the script, the generate 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 script. Try debugging that. And for fun, that was I think my most legacy project ever, because no one was ever able to make any no one was actually sure what the system was supposed to do. And again, my company made the decision to have a bug for bug compatibility. And at some point, we have we go to the customer and says, look, in your script, there is a, you write in a data to a table, and then there is a data conversion error, and then it's thrown out, and because of a white space issue, I kid you not, instead of calling a rollback, a commit is called. Okay, so you import data into a table, there is an error, you commit and move on. And the data is sorted based on the internal sorting matrix of Oracle, so I don't, even if I wanted to, I can't replicate that. Then we had a 3 hours meeting on that. But at some point, there was this script. I can still remember its name. It's 7 ASCII letters, .SQL. The reason that I still remember it is that it's 3,000 lines of PLSQL code that I spent 3 days just reading. Like, now, I was reading that, and I had this big Oracle PLSQL book, and I was flipping through that, trying to understand what's going on, and I couldn't. Like, I could not understand for the life of me what was going on in there. And at some point, now, I'm in a cubicle farm inside a bank, and everyone is, you know, as a developer in a bank, you show up in a suit, and you have a tie, and everything is very proper. Okay, well, you have to pay for being able to leave the office at 5:01. But, so try to imagine me. And I'm a consultant. I show up basically like this. Actually, I wasn't married at the time, so I showed up considerably worse than this. And I show up, and basically I'm just like this for 3 days straight. And at some point around noon, I stand up and I start cursing. What ended up happening there was that there was 3,000 lines of PLSQL code to do a group by. Now, you have to understand that at this point, I went into the changelog of the system, found out who wrote the code in the first place, and then went and pulled the Oracle manual of the time to make sure that Oracle actually had a group by when that version was out. It did, by the way. So basically, we have the transactions table, and what this piece of script was supposed to do was, okay, I need to see a aggregated statistic by a sub-account, account, parent account, a branch, blah, 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 7 levels of statistics of how much money moved between those things. Now, the way that he did that was, okay, let's open a cursor on a branch, and then a cursor on account, then cursor on that, and cursor on that. Let's do that all over again. That particular script was 3.5 hours of the entire process. I rewrote that to be a really scary group by statement that ran on SQL Server for 30 seconds. Then I got pissed off and I backported that to Oracle to see how long it would run there, and it ran in 2 minutes. And basically, at that point, I have to go to manager and say, okay, if we replace this single script, they have another 5 years before they have to worry about the system again. Unfortunately, at that point, the customer representative couldn't back out. They already invested several, three people time, 4 months, do the math. Lots of money into that, and apparently it would have been too embarrassing to say, oh, we could just replace this script. It would have cost us, you know, a month's work of someone who actually knew what they were doing and would save all of this money. So now, the reason that I started telling this story is that we actually is actually related to the architecture and the sort of decision that people are making. And one of the things that you need to understand is that people make decisions based on a whole lot of complex set of rules. What's good for me personally, what's good for my team, what's good for the company. And it's not really in any way, shape, or form one-sided. People generally aren't bad. You can start with that. They try to do whatever is good for them, and for good for them is not saying, okay, today I got up and I stabbed my employer in the back. But how many of you know Altizian, Jira, Confluence, stuff like that? I was sitting in a session with either the CTO or the CEO, and they told us about a change they made in their sales strategy that was responsible for 50% increase in the revenue. Now, I don't know if you are aware of that. 50% revenue usually means that someone had to kill a chicken and wave them around, or some other sort of black magic. And what they did was basically something like this. If you buy, and again, this is 7-8 years out of date, I don't know if this is relevant anymore, but at the time, they said, if you buy an enterprise version of Jira, for example, we'll give you a free t-shirt. Now, how much does a t-shirt cost? Anyone knows? Let's say $30, including shipping, $30. How much enterprise version of Jira cost? I don't know, but a lot. 4 or 5 figures. Now, what's going on there? What's going on there is that when the person making the purchase, it goes like this. Okay, it doesn't actually matter to me personally, because it's not my money, if you buy the Jira version that is $500 or $5,000. But I get a t-shirt if you get the $5,000. Okay? So at that point, people will literally convince themselves that the extra features that they need for the enterprise edition are worth the extra price. And by the way, they get a t-shirt. By the way, if you care about this, the world of pricing and the psychology of prices and how you can affect it is fascinating and scary topic. So, going back to architecture, and by the way, notice that I intentionally don't focus on code here, because my point is that you shouldn't look at the code.
Why are you showing that particular
image? It's beautiful.
No,
I know that's the opera in Sydney,
yeah.
And I don't know the story. Could
it's
you educate me?
It's designed by a Danish architect,
mm-hmm.
And it's built with Swedish building material.
Okay.
The interesting point here is the fact that the architect got so frustrated by the building process that he renounced his name. He said, "You're not allowed to put my name on this building."
Okay. Yeah, I think that at this point he would regret that, but...
His son has gone the other way around and said, "Yeah, no, it was my father. It was my father.
Now, yeah, makes sense.
During his lifetime, his father said, "No, I didn't build it."
Yeah. The nice thing about this, if you look for architecture in Google, this comes up as one of the first pictures. That's the reason it's here. But so basically the problem is that the whole concept is, what are you trying to do at work? Are you trying to create a product? Are you trying to do something... that will make you happy, or are you trying to actually, you know, get this login form working again? One of the things that you have to also remember is that those are not mutually exclusive options. For example, I have a guy that I think he dreams performance optimizations. Like, he goes to bed and he dreams in assembly, because he comes back and he starts writing stuff that... Okay, I can see that. So here we write most of our software in C#. So he rewrites the code to do the exact same thing, but in this JIT version, the output in assembly means that on x64 we get another 3% benefit. Now, to be fair, this piece of code got called. 10 billion times per hour, maybe more. So it was measurably better. But how do you get there? I don't know. Now, in my case, I think that this guy is wonderful. Crazy, but wonderful. Because it means that I can then come to you and if you aren't aware, what I do for a living is I write databases, and there's a whole bunch of those still in here if you want them. And I can come back to you and say, look, we improve performance by X percent. And that's a marketable feature that I can use. At one point, I was a consulting in a company that we use in RavenDB, and we had a small features that, honestly, we did because we were bored. I was there for, they hired me for 3 days. After 2.5 days, we were done. And it considered rude to say, okay, bye. You still pay for the half day, but bye. So we basically started looking at cool stuff that we can do because, you know, they already paid for my time. My flight was leaving at 11 p.m. I didn't want to sit at the bar all this time. So what the hell? So we basically did a suggestion feature. RavenDB has a feature that basically, if you make a query and there is not, then and you didn't get a result, then you can ask the database, try to figure out what the user meant. It's based on string distance algorithm, Levenstein and Engram and Jarowinkel, and all bunch of stuff like that. It's really interesting from a technical perspective. Users generally, I speak about Levenstein and I think like, who's that guy and how much he's paying me? And but we just basically did that. It's maybe 20 lines of code. And I get a very irate call from them about 2 months later when they actually released the software to customers. And apparently they forgot to remove this code. And guys who are actually writing actually using the software found out that they have this feature, and they went crazy. And now the next 2 iteration of those guys will basically go and do that same thing on all the textbooks in the system, because apparently it was much, much easier. The guys in question, you have all of those strange things on the letters, umlauts, and or with the slash and or without the slash and all sort of stuff like that. So those guys were from Norway and they also have this problem, and apparently not being forced to really accurately get the right, what's the name of this, by the way? The name of the, is there a generic name for those letters?
Special characters.
Yes, whatever, yeah. The name of those, apparently getting the ASCII out properly was enough of a problem that if you just, you know, could guess, okay, JSON without JSON with the 2 dots on the top, then that was wonderful. Hebrew has something similar, although you can basically tack them on any letter whatsoever, and no one uses that for any reason at all. So that's an example of a feature that you try, and it apparently had a huge impact. But it was literally a boredom feature. By the way, Gmail is another boredom feature at Google. So you can see that those are cool, but the question is, what do you do with them? And the question is, this text box is my boredom feature, or this is my boredom feature? Another thing to remember is Conway's law. This is the formal statement. The typical informal way of stating that is saying, if you have 4 teams building a compiler, you're going to end up with a 4-pass compiler. Anyone familiar with that? Seen it before? Yeah. What's the problem with that? A, it tends to be true. B, when people try to break that, then they end up paying a lot. Anyone was ever on the downstream team from a team of monkeys? So I rely on code that was written by basically a team of drunk monkeys hopped up on caffeine and heroin. Anyone? Isn't this fun? So, So Yeah. You're the monkey? So now, by the way, that also applies to me. I'm standing here, I'm talking, and I haven't actually written business software in months, probably years. What I do for a living, I write database systems, like the actual database. And my concern most of the time are things like, where was that? Yes. So my concern at the time, my concern currently is, how well can I support this in production? Do I have the appropriate log output? Do I have a good backup strategy? And what happens if system goes down? Most business software is mostly concerned with, is this label aligned with the rest of the page? And do I have the appropriate tab order? And don't you just hate those bugs? I have a really good QA team, and one, I swear to you that one of those guys is just looking, just stop nitpicking. It's okay, it's working. I don't care. Who cares about tab orders? I mean, use a mouse. Yeah, I know, but still, spending whole day doing tab order bug fixes, that's not a good day. I need to do something with real meat on that to feel good about myself. Hence, by the way, these guys. Okay, so a lot of that is about how do we structure the system. Now, with the caveat that those applies to me, I'm standing here telling you how to design your systems, and then I'm going to go away and build another database product while you're stuck trying to maintain something that you build based on the world of someone who is never seen the project, never actually had a conversation with the business. But, you know, this is my template. It works for everyone. Go ahead and do that. Something that I found really worked for business systems is to name them. What do I mean by naming them? I mean that I actually, in my organization, the component responsible for a payroll, responsible for a invoicing is called Dahlia. Okay? It's the office, she is the office manager. She's a person, you know, feet, head, knows how to drive, and also has the decision-making capabilities. So from my perspective, and a lot of the time my interaction with this component is invoice them, why didn't we invoice them yet? And oh, great that they paid that finally. Hopefully she will not see this video, otherwise I would have to deal with fault handling, I guess. But that's a good way of thinking about your system. As an independent component or actors, and I hate myself for using that word because that's an architectural term, that work together to do something. A lot of the time, that really depends on the structure of your organization. If you're working in a layer organization, then you need to consider whatever you actually want to explicitly. Either accept that based on Conway's law, you're going to have, you end up with the same organization as you have the communication structure between the people, or you restructure the communication between people based on how you want the software to end up being. Another issue is that, think about it. When you have people in the software, every people is a component, then you have to discuss what sort of relationship they have between them. It actually makes more sense when you say, okay, we have Jane as the web server, and Jane talked to Dahlia, but Dahlia doesn't trust Jane, so she needs to recheck her work every time, and stuff like that. It also makes for relatively fun design decisions and some nasty code comments. So another issue about this is that all of my company is using Gmail for email, and Dahlia uses Outlook. That has impact on the way she works versus everyone else, and occasionally requires additional resources from someone, some of the technical team to fix her Outlooks for her. But in general, we don't care. I mean, I don't care that she reads me in Outlook or on the phone or in Gmail. It can just work. That's a good way of talking about encapsulation. About, okay, this is my system, this is how it works. Now, another problem that we have is, how do you actually consider the system to work? So what do I mean by that? I mean that, okay, let's say that you decided to accept the advice of a total stranger and re-architect your entire system based on what I'm saying. What's the problem with that? Let's say that we have we currently have 4 people working on this project. And Jane is really good with CSS, and John is really good with writing optimized queries to the database. They fall into those end of the spectrums where, okay, I'm mostly working here, I'm mostly working there, and that's about it. If you try to say, okay, let's talk about human components and let's just, how do you structure the code? How do you structure responsibility? Is it possible when a bug is open on the system, who is going to take that? What happens if John takes a vacation? What happens if Jane takes a vacation? No one knows how the CSS works. And so you need to actually make explicit, I want to say, design decisions. But they aren't design decisions, they are organizational decisions about how you structure this. And most of the time, people don't make those kind of decisions explicitly. How many of you know the term microservices? How many of you use them? How many of you have a microservice repository? So you have a different source repository per microservice? How many of you ever had to fix a bug that crosses multiple microservice boundaries? How much fun is that? Okay? So I need to fix this, and then this, and this, 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 and I have to make a fix here, then take the binaries, put them here, then take the binaries, put them here, then take the binaries, put them here, and might as well just shoot me. Okay, so I wanted to, a while ago in Israel, they passed a law that forced all of the supermarkets to publish their data. What do you mean publish the data? Publish the pricing information. For this company, for example, in photos branch at the end of the street, the price of milk is X, the price of blah is blah, whatever. Now, the idea here is that commercial companies would come up, analyze this data, and give you a way to access that normally. Now, the funny thing about this is that the law stated that the data has to be computer accessible. So all of the company complied with that and produced horrendously annoying XML files, hundreds of megabytes long, and they updated every hour, and a whole bunch of stuff like that. The newspaper complained about this because no one thought about producing human-readable Excel files. That was very funny from a technical perspective. But we actually sat down at work with one of the guys and had a whole design decision about how would we build something like that. And it's a good exercise, and I want to take the time to do that. We never build that. That's too complex, but let's talk about this. When we talk about something like a supermarket price comparer, what do we need? What are the core components in the system? What data? So we have the data from the stores. They are made available as XML files on an FTP site. For the purpose of this discussion, let's assume that that you have a list of those FTP sites and the credential to access them. Okay, what else? So the first thing that we need to do, we need to write some sort of a crawler to go into those websites, get the data, parse them, and do something with that. Okay. What else?
Maybe a database.
A database. Okay. You write a database. Great. What else? So you need some component that takes different structures from the different stores and put them into a unified schema that you use. What else?
Display the data.
Some sort of way of displaying the information, okay. What else? You need a UI to create a shopping cart of all of the things that we want to do. Now, how many of those things should be handled as separate teams? Is there a relationship between the crawler and the database and the UI?
Probably not the crawler.
Okay.
So
the conversion from the files to the data is important.
Mm-hmm. Format, then suddenly your unified format is worthless.
Yeah. More than that, consider a really a simple scenario. I want to be able to say when was the last... I need to present some sort of information on the website, such as, okay, I need to see I want to be able to show you a graph of a particular product price per location or per something, because you know what, the price of tomatoes has gone up really in quite a lot. So maybe you don't want to buy tomato this week, stuff like that. So I need historical information. That's a feature that is driven by the UI team, actually the data team from that perspective, but it crossed the entire section. That's what I mean, that the communication structure and the physical structure of this has to be really important. The downside of that, the more communication that you have, the slower things become. How many of you ever had a full day of meetings? Yeah. By the way, I was at a meeting about a different architectural decisions where the downside of an architect of a particular decision was that we need to buy a new server. And at some point I just started counting the number of people in the room and timing the billable hours, and I said, okay, the decision to actually go ahead with buying the new servers or not, the cost of the meeting would have been triple the cost of the new servers. But no, they really needed the OPSEC opinion about that. Never mind. So it's funny. By the way, one of the things that I like to do in talks is to make fun by making snide comments like that. It's funny and I get lots of laugh. I'm not that bitter. Yes, so anyway, although some customers. So anyway, when we start talking about the cost of communication, we tend to want to split things up. And you mentioned data. I don't want to deal with I don't want the crawler and the compare and the web app to have the same database. Why should they? The moment they have the same database, then that means that if the web app needs a new field, it needs to talk to the crawler guys. The crawler guys are on vacation because they watch too much XML files and now they really need to rest on the beach. Okay? So a lot of the time I would actually say, no, you're independent. You're absolutely independent, including all of the data is duplicated. But what I defined is the data pathways between all of you. So I'm going to say the compare takes the data from this database on an hourly basis. And we define that it calls those stop procedure, or it executes this ETL component. And if they change something, they're responsible for doing that. Now, you would still have the cross-team features. If you need an additional piece of information from the caller, you have to talk to the caller guys. They're annoying, but you know, you plug your nose and do that. Now, the interesting thing about this, most of the time when people talk about the supermarket comparer, they really focus on getting the data, so the caller part, and getting the shopping cart and stuff like that. From my perspective, when I look at something like that, I think that the interesting thing is in the cart valuator. So given that you have a cart, give me the best place to buy that cart. And why is that such a complex thing to do? I mean, is it just, you know, I have a list, compare it versus all of the locations that I have, and I'm done. Why is that complex? It's complex because now you have a lot of interesting rules. Let's say that when I when we specify my cart, I said that I want 3% milk of company A. But in this location, there are, the term we use is substitute product. There is a private label that is 20% cheaper. And if you and you said that you wanted three bottles of Coke, but you can get 6 bottles of Cokes for only $2 more, and it's cheaper on a per unit basis. And then you get into things like, wait a second, if you have if you're a member in this market, and if you're not a member but you want to join, you want to join them, and a whole bunch of really crazy business rules that you can apply that actually give you the main benefit.